Thank you so much for coming out on this beautiful, dare I say it, spring evening. And welcome to this iteration of the Rotman Public Lecture. I'm Mike Anderson. I'm a professor at the Rotman Institute of Philosophy here at Western University. If you don't know, a Rotman Institute is dedicated to fostering productive dialogue between philosophy and the sciences. And this year marks our 10th anniversary. Part of the mission of the Institute is public outreach, hence tonight's event. And we do run these Rotman public lectures a couple times a year, so please look for them. But please also look out for our library lecture series and our public panel discussions. Past events have covered topics including climate change, happiness and well-being, robot ethics, animal rights, Einstein's legacy, parenting, altruism, and much more. You can connect with us via Facebook, via Twitter, and also, obviously, old school technology, our website. Now, given the Rotman history and mission, we couldn't be more pleased to be hosting Dr. Lisa Feldman Barrett. Dr. Barrett is the University Distinguished Professor of Psychology at Northeastern University in Boston, Massachusetts. And I could continue to list titles and honors and grants and awards because the list is long. But I'm not going to. That's a resume, and frankly, the resume is nice, but it's not important. Here's the thing that you all need to know. Lisa Feldman Barrett is the most creative, insightful, and iconoclastic scientist of our age. She has literally upended the science of emotion with decades of pioneering research. And I understand she's poised to do the same with the evolution of the human brain. So stay tuned for that. Hope that wasn't a secret.
No. It isn't now.
Dr. Barrett is most recently author of How Emotions Are Made, The Secret Life of the Brain. And that's a masterpiece of both science and communication that I hope many of you had the opportunity to purchase before you came in. If you did not, you will want to after, and I do believe they will still be there to give you that opportunity. Dr. Feldman Barrett is here tonight to speak to us about emotions and her work there. And as you say, separating fact from fiction, what are emotions? How do they work? What's true? What's false? It's a great honor and a great privilege to welcome you to the stage. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Lisa Feldman Barrett.
That was lovely. Thank you. You bet. You know, one of the great, I don't know why I'm using this, I'm actually mic'd. One of the great benefits of being a scientist is that you get to be introduced by people who you admire, whose work is inspirational to you. So that was beautiful, Mike. Thank you so much, and particularly meaningful coming from you. So I want to thank everybody. I want to thank the Rotman Institute of Philosophy. I want to thank the library. I want to thank all of you for coming out this evening. Today we're going to talk about the nature of emotion. And to start us off, I'm going to ask you a deep philosophical question. Who here likes cartoons? Me too. So cartoon chemistry is about mixing colorful liquids in test tubes until they explode. Cartoon physics is about running off a cliff and not falling until you look down. Don't you wish you could do that? So thanks to Pixar, the science of emotion now has its own cartoons. These are little characters that live in our brains, one for joy, sadness, disgust, fear, and anger. And of course, joy is the leader because Pixar is located in the United States, where we have 500 best-selling books on how to be happy. Now, none of us really expect to learn how chemistry works or how physics works from watching cartoons. But when it comes to emotion, Pixar's Inside Out was inspired by the set of ideas that actually make up a prominent scientific view of how emotions work. And many interviews were given when this film came out to testify to that effect. That this movie was inspired by cutting-edge research on our best understanding of what emotions are and how they work. And I'm here to tell you today that the facts of this approach, although they're wildly popular, and they really match, you know, I would say our common sense beliefs about emotions, are pretty much as fictional as Wile E. Coyote. That was much funnier than the laugh I just got for that joke. So I just want to tell you, thank you. It's better. Better. So today we're really going to encounter three fictions. I'm going to tell you a little bit about these fictions in the next, 45 minutes or so. And then after we've squashed them, I'm going to give you kind of a snapshot, a kind of a, 20,000 foot view of our best understanding scientifically of actually how emotions are made. And to do this, we're going to start with the first fiction, the one that's very popular these days, and that is that emotions are displayed on the face with expressions that we recognize. So people are supposed to smile when they're happy, they're supposed to frown when they're sad, they're supposed to scowl when they're angry. Everyone around the world is supposed to be able to recognize smiles and frowns and scowls as expressions of emotion. Technology companies are in the news all the time telling us that they can read emotions in faces. And to show you that this is a fiction, I could really inspire you by showing you summaries of literally hundreds of studies to make the point that I want to make. And I know you'd all be interested at 7 o'clock at night to be looking at hundreds of studies. But instead, okay, I thought that was also sort of funny, but okay, it's fine. It's fine. I'm almost going to stop making jokes, actually. I'm just going to, what I'm going to do is just summarize with an example, which, and I can say, it's not hyperbole for me to tell you that I'm summarizing hundreds of studies here, because I actually just completed a large summary of the literature with four other senior colleagues, all of whom came from different theoretical points of view at the outset of this paper, and we read really over 1,000 research articles, and in one of the great scientific moments of my life, we all came to consensus about what the data said. When is that going to happen again? So here's basically the summary. When people look at this girl and they infer how she's feeling, they see grief or sadness or fatigue. But this is actually my daughter Sophia from a couple of years ago when I took her to the chocolate museum in Cologne, Germany. Sophia is experienced, Sophia's on her second chocolate drink here. And she is experiencing what I can only describe to you as a deep, profound sense of pleasure. Now, this little sweetheart is also experiencing pleasure. And if you look on the internet, you can see there are lots of examples of that. You know, there's a really great example that one of my former graduate students uses of a girl who has just been given her first kitten. For her birthday, and she's just, if you turned the sound off and you didn't know what was going on, and you removed the context, she looks like she's hysterically, like a tragedy has just occurred. She's sobbing, basically, almost uncontrollably. And so the message here is that people move their faces in many different ways during instances of the same emotion category. And when we just, for example, look at the eyebrow region of this little guy, he's making a facial movement that is very reminiscent of the proposed universal expression for anger. So, for example, this guy, when you just look at him without context, looks like he's furious. This is actually a picture of Jim Webb after he won the 2006 senatorial race in Virginia, returning the Senate to Democratic control with his victory. Now, I realize I'm in Canada, and that this might not be a moment of, profound meaning for you, But I like to use this example when I'm talking to people in the States. And it mostly works if you're in most states, it works as a good example. There are a couple of states where you just would not want to stand up on stage and say that. But if you look at his face without context, he looks like he's furious because, in fact, this is the face that symbolizes anger in our culture. So people don't only move their faces in different ways during instances of the same emotion category. They also move their faces in exactly the same way during instances of different emotion categories. And so the punchline here is that when it comes to emotion, a face does not speak for itself. Instead, when you see an emotion in another person, your brain is actually guessing, automatically and effortlessly, guessing what those facial movements mean. And these guesses are happening all the time without your awareness. And even people, even those of us who believe, are very confident that we are reading emotions in other people's faces, our brains are really just guessing. They're making meaning of the raise of an eyebrow, the curl of a lip, the tilt of a head. And this is how a single facial movement, like a smile, can actually have drastically different meanings in different situations or contexts. That when it comes to emotion, variation is the norm. This is true definitely in faces, in facial movements. So for example, on average, the research shows that people scowl about 30% of the time when they're angry. They also do many other things when they're angry. They smile when they're angry. They sit stone-faced, probably plotting the demise of their enemy in anger. They cry in anger. They do many things in anger. And people scowl at many times when they're not angry, when they're confused, when they're concentrating really hard. My husband makes a full-on facial scowl when he's concentrating really hard. And it took me I'm an emotion researcher, right? I spent almost 30 years studying this, and I still have moments where I think, is he angry? And apparently I do this too, which much to the chagrin of my graduate students, when they're giving a presentation and I'm concentrating really hard, I'm basically scowling at them. And people scowl when they have gas. I mean, people scowl for all kinds of reasons. And actually, if you look at Inside Out, what you see is that Mr. Anger here actually makes all kinds of faces and actually has all categories of emotion. Because, as a character, he'd be super boring if he only if there was no variability in his behavior. The next fiction pretty much has the same kind of story. The fiction is that each emotion has a unique pattern of changes, physical changes in the body. So the idea is that your heart rate is supposed to race in fear, your blood pressure is supposed to go up in anger, and so on and so forth, and that there's a specific diagnostic pattern of physical changes in your body, like a fingerprint, that will identify the emotion that someone's in. And there's a very interesting story here about where this fiction arose. It purportedly arose with William James, the great William James, who was considered one of the fathers of modern American psychology. Actually, the irony, as I talk about in my book, is that William James actually said the opposite. Can you imagine becoming famous for the opposite of something that you said, actually wrote many times in many papers and in the most famous book of all in psychology? And basically, William James said that every emotion which feels different has a different bodily comportment. And so he was referring here to what philosophers call tokens, not types. He wasn't referring to the category anger, he was referring to instances of anger. And in fact, he actually writes, there is no anger in an entitative sense. There is no physical fingerprint which identifies anger. And physiologists have actually known this since the 1970s. If you consider all the things that might make you happy, taking a leisurely walk in the woods, or lying on in the sun on a bucolic beach, or baking a cake for your family and friends, or doing a yoga class, or gossiping with your friends over coffee—I mean, talking with your friends over coffee—or gardening in your backyard. Each of these actions that you are taking in happiness
it has a different physical action. And physiologists have known since the 1970s that the physiological state of your body follows your actions. It actually is linked to your actions or to your preparation for action. So if you act in many different ways instances of the same emotion category, your body's going to be doing very different things. So again, variability is the norm. And it's also the case that exactly the same physiological pattern can occur in instances of different emotion categories. So for example, we see a similar pattern in anxiety and in the beginning stages of a cardiac arrest. And in fact, women in the United States over the age of 65 are more likely to die from a heart attack than men because they go to the doctor, they go to the emergency room with symptoms that feel they're more likely to categorize and interpret as anxiety, and so is the physician, and the physician sends them home and they die from a heart attack. And this actually happened to, so this is, people have published papers about this. This actually happened to a friend of mine, actually the publicist of my book in the UK. Her mother passed away in exactly this fashion. And a really good friend of mine who's a physiologist, who his name is Jim Cohn, he's at the University of Virginia, he interviewed me for his podcast called Circle of Willis, where I was telling him about this story. And then Jim had his own little episode where he almost died from a heart attack. He went to the hospital. They told him they checked him out. They told him he had anxiety. He was preparing to leave, but was in so much pain that they decided to hold him for further tests. So at that's the point at which the woman would have gotten sent home. He waited in the emergency room. The cardiologist walked into the room, and he had a massive heart attack, which is called a widowmaker. And if he hadn't been in the hospital room at that moment, he would have died. And the interesting part of the story for me is that Jim only went to the hospital because he remembered our conversation. He was actually going to bed and was in extreme discomfort and just, then remembered this conversation that we'd had and thought, okay, they're just going to tell me I have anxiety, but I'm going to go anyways. And he did, and it saved his life. And he talks about it in he's a much better storyteller than I am. And he talks about it on his Halloween edition of his podcast, Circle of Willis. So I encourage you to go and have a listen to it. So physical changes in your body, the research shows, really have no inherent emotional meaning. Your brain makes them meaningful as emotions. That is, your brain, part of what its job is to make sensations from your body related to the changes in your body, heart rate changes, respiratory changes, and so on, to make them meaningful. And sometimes your brain makes them meaningful as an emotion. So a change in heart rate or a change in blood pressure doesn't inherently have an emotional meaning. The third fiction for tonight is that each emotion has its own dedicated character or circuit in the brain. Now, I'm a neuroscientist, so I have to show at least one brain image in every talk, or I get kicked out of the club. So I'm going to show you one image and one finding from a meta-analysis, which is a statistical summary of hundreds of studies. And what I'm about to show you basically generalizes to any analysis that we could do. But this is a pretty straightforward analysis, I think. So here what you're looking at is a slice of a brain. So if you were to take your brain or my brain and slice it down this way, which I'm sure many of my colleagues would like to do, slice the brain this way, pop off your face and you look in the mirror, that's what you'd see. I mean, it'd be more bloody, obviously, but that's what you would see. And what I've done here is I've circled a brain region called the amygdala. So how many people here have heard of the amygdala? Yeah, I know, right? It's like the rock star of brain regions. A lot of people like to write about it. And for many years, scientists believed that the amygdala contained the circuitry for fear. It was the home of fear. And so what I'm going to show you, what I'm showing you now is the proportion of brain imaging studies where people were experiencing fear, and we also see an increase in activity in the amygdala. So this is about almost 30% of the studies. So the proportion is there on the vertical axis. And that's more than what you'd expect by chance. So it is true that sometimes when people are feeling fearful, they show an increase in a corresponding increase in amygdala activity. But 30% is not what you would expect if this brain region contains the circuitry for fear. You'd expect something much more. Maybe not 100% because, you know, all studies have error and so on and so forth. But you certainly would expect more than 30%. And it turns out every emotion category that's ever been studied shows an increase in activity in the amygdala some proportion of the time. And in fact, many studies in memory, for example, routinely show amygdala activity for completely neutral faces and images and so on. So if I just showed you an image or a face that you'd never seen before and I was imaging your brain, I'd see a huge increase in amygdala activity just because it's novel. And your brain is basically has to decide whether or not it's going to learn this novel information, whether it's useful enough to you that it will learn it, or whether it can ignore it as error. And your brain, your amygdala is partially responsible for that process. And really, this finding that I'm showing you here holds for every brain region that's ever been purported to be the home of an emotion, of holding the neurons that are the circuit for that emotion. And it doesn't really matter whether we look at individual activity in individual brain regions, or whether we look at networks in the brain, or whether we look at patterns of distributed activity. We pretty much find the same kind of result. This is not random. It's not like the brain is doing something random. It's just responding to variability. Variation is important. Variation here is also the norm. And I should also say, we could not be talking about brain imaging. We could talk about lesion studies. So there are studies of people who have lost their amygdalas. Actually, there's a really interesting study of a woman named SM who has complete calcification of both amygdala. And at first it was assumed she couldn't perceive or experience fear, but it turns out that she can, actually, under certain circumstances, experience fear, learn about fear, perceive fear in other people. There's a case of monozygotic twins, so they share 100% of their genetic material. One has problems with fear, the other one doesn't. There's a longer story here to explain exactly how this could be true, but the sort of 20,000-foot punchline here is that emotions are complex constructions in your brain. They're not simple circuits. Your brain does not have an emotional control panel operated by little characters, even if it feels that way to us sometimes. The idea that your brain comes pre-wired with ancient emotion circuits buried deep inside some animalistic part of your brain is what philosophers often call essentialism. I have to tell you that, giving a talk like this, where I say stuff like that, where there are a bunch of philosophers in the room, is really nerve-wracking. but I think it's called essentialism to assume this. And essentialism might not be good science, but it's like really good entertainment. It makes for some pretty funny scenes in Inside Out. But in reality, there are no circuits in her head, in his head, or even in his head. There are none in your head either, or mine. That makes the puzzle of what emotions are and how they work really interesting. Because, what are our brains doing, actually, if those circuits aren't there, lurking in the wiring from before we're born? And so part of the answer actually first has to come before we start talking about what the brain actually is doing, we sort of have to figure out, why is it that we have these beliefs that each emotion is kind of like a little character in your brain at a control panel? Why is it that we believe that each emotion category has its own diagnostic facial expression or its own brain circuit or its own unique bodily fingerprint. What's up with these faces? And why do people believe, why are people in industry spending literally billions of dollars along with, you know, countless hours from some of the most creative scientists we have in the world trying to detect emotion by reading these faces? And the answer really is that they're stereotypes. They're caricatures that were stipulated by a handful of scientists and then adopted as truth. These faces and the bodily patterns and so on were not discovered by scientists. They were stipulated by scientists. So basically, what much of the older literature on emotion is a science of emojis. And because they are examples of essentialism, people find them pretty hard to relinquish, these beliefs, these stereotypes, even when the preponderance of scientific evidence doesn't support them. And so partly I wrote this book because I thought it was really important for people to know that this other literature is out there. They can read the literature, it's like a pointer to that literature, and they can decide for themselves what they think. It's also important because people are harmed, I think, by that in the public sector, decisions are sometimes made on people's outcomes, including that have implications not just for their livelihood or their freedom, but actually sometimes their lives, based on what I perceive to be incorrect information. So what I want to do now is just turn to the idea of what your brain is doing, and what I'm going to suggest to you today is that even though to all of us it feels like emotions are reactions to things that happen in the world, I want to suggest to you that that's actually not the way things work. That our brains are kind of a mastery, they're like a master of deception, right? They sort of trick us into believing certain things, that they work in a certain way when they don't work that way at all. So to us it feels like, you know, that we're perfectly calm and then something happens in the world and it triggers an emotion and then that emotion causes us to do or say things that maybe are sometimes ill-advised. Sometimes. But that's actually not what's happening under the hood. And that instead, emotions are really better understood as your brain's understanding of what is going on inside your own body in relation to what is happening around you in the world, so that your brain can figure out what to do next to keep you alive and well. So your brain doesn't encounter a situation and then evaluate it and figure out what the situation means and then react to it with an emotion. Emotions, in a sense, are what situations mean to you in an embodied way. They are not built into your brain from birth. They are built by your brain as needed on a situation-by-situation basis, hence the variability. So the idea here that I'm suggesting is that contrary to our own experience of things, the phenomenology of what it feels like to have an emotion, emotions actually don't happen to you. They're actually made by you. They're actually made by your brain in concert with information from the world and from your body. And the idea here is that an emotion is an event where your whole brain is making meaning of internal sensations in your body in relation to what's going on around you in the world. And this is how the same ache in your gut can be hunger, can be anxiety, or longing, or a feeling of distrust that someone is, you know, not to be trusted. So how does your brain do this? Well, what I'm going to suggest to you today is something that scientists, scientists have known for a long time, which is that your brain is a model of the world. It's an internal model, or sometimes called a working model. That model includes you, your body, and it's built from prior experiences. So the idea here is that your brain is basically, running a model, and that model is the source of all feelings and thoughts and actions that you take. And to explain this, I just want to give you a perspective from your. I want us to start with the brain's perspective on things. So, as many people who've talked to me before have heard me say, and I talk about in the book, much of research in emotion, and actually research in psychology in general, really starts with folk psychology categories: anger, sadness, fear, memory, belief, perception, and so on. And then it goes looking for the physical basis of those categories in the brain and in the body. Psychology started off this way as a science, and it persists. This is the strategy that persists. But some of us take a different view. We actually start with the brain and the rest of the nervous system and the body and say, okay, well, a brain that's connected to a body in a social context populated by other brains in bodies, what is a brain like that? How does a brain like that work? And if we understand, if we take the best guess, our best guesses of how a brain like that works, how does a brain like that control our actions and create our experiences in a way that makes sense to us? And so this is the, right, I'm going to show you really my best guess based on the research from my own lab and the research really from hundreds of other labs around the world, not only in psychology and in neuroscience, but also in electrical engineering and in physiology and related fields. And so if we start with your brain's perspective, your brain is basically trapped in a dark, silent box called your skull. And your brain has a really difficult job. It receives sensory inputs through the sensors of your body, right? Light through your retina, through your eyes, changes in pressures, air pressure through the cochlea of your ear, and so on and so forth. And these sensory changes are the effects of some cause in the world. But your brain doesn't have access to the causes. It only has access to the effects. It actually has to guess at what the causes are. So any given flash of light, any given change in air pressure, can have many different causes. And the information is not complete. It's kind of noisy and ambiguous. So it's noisy, it's ambiguous, and it has more than one cause, and your brain only has the effects, and it's got to guess at what the causes are. And this is also true about information that comes to your brain from your body. That information, which comes from your lungs expanding and contracting, your heart beating, the changes in glucose and in inflammation and so on and so forth, temperature changes due to inflammation, all of this sensory information comes to your brain as the effect of some cause which your brain doesn't know. It has to guess. This guessing about the causes only from knowing the effects is called reverse inference, or it's called inverse inference. But basically, you have to guess at the cause by only knowing the consequence. And so how does your brain do this? How does it know whether an ache in your gut is longing or anxiety or hunger? How does it know whether a beating heart and a flushed face is lust or anxiety or the beginnings of a heart attack? I know, it's really funny to put those together, right? But there you go. That's science for you. Well, it has one more piece of information that's available to it, and that is your past experience. So your brain solves its reverse inference problem using experiences that are encoded or that are conjured in the conversation between neurons that are bathed in a chemical system. And what your brain is doing is it's remembering past experiences that are similar in some way to present conditions. When the physical changes in the world and in the body are similar in some way to present conditions. So your brain isn't asking, what are these sensations? What is this sensory input? It's asking, what are these like? What are these similar to in my past? Now, in science, a bunch of things which are similar to each other in some way is a category. So you could say that what your brain is doing is constructing categories. It's basically drawing on its past experience to construct categories that are its best guess about what the causes are of the sensory effects that it receives from the world and from the body. But the representation of a category is a concept. And so another way to think about what the brain is doing is it's making concepts or ad hoc concepts. This is what we call it in cognitive science. Ad hoc concept meaning a concept that your brain is making on the fly as needed based on the situation. So your brain is basically dynamically creating concepts on the fly from past experience, reinstating patterns of past experience that are similar to the present conditions as a way of making sense of the current sensory conditions so that your brain can figure out what to do next to keep you alive and well. And, you know, to achieve your most important job, which is to pass your genes on to the next generation. Not in every moment, obviously. Well, I mean, for most of us, right? So, and when it reinstates past instances that you have learned or that someone taught you were anger or sadness or fear, then what your brain is doing is constructing an emotion concept and making sense of the sensations as emotions. And it's, so if that, you know, that seems like a very convoluted thing to say, but actually that's what the data appears to suggest very strongly. And if that's not preposterous enough, then I'll tell you that your brain is actually doing this predictively. So your brain doesn't react to things pretty much ever. The suggestion strongly from a number of different scientific domains all point to the idea that your brain is actually doing this predictively. And so just to show you what I mean, there are a lot of examples for how I could show you this. And actually on my website, not my academic website where, you know, everything's very serious with peer-reviewed publications, but on my personal website, I have a lot of examples. But I'm going to use this example today just to show you what I mean. Once upon a time, in a magical kingdom far, far away, there lived a beautiful princess. Yeah. And wouldn't it have been surprising if I'd said, you know, an orangutan or a car or a king? Well, if it were a Monty Python skit, that would have worked as a king. Or my personal favorite, a drag queen. A queen, but a drag queen. By the way, this is a new Netflix cartoon about drag queen superheroes. Yeah, which is going to be on. Sorry. So it seems to you, right, that you're basically just listening and reacting to what you hear, right? That you're reacting to what I'm saying, but in fact, your brain is predicting every single word that comes out of my. And wouldn't it have been surprising if I said some other orifice of my body, right? It would have been really right. So we do things predictively. That's not our experience, right? But our brain is working predictively. And it's creating, when it's combining past experiences, sometimes it's doing it in a novel way. So, for example, what's this? A cat. How many of you have seen this cat before? Yeah, right. You haven't seen this cat before. Personally, I don't know any cat that actually looks like that. Before you've gone to the bar, there are kids here. Nobody goes to the bar. Sorry, that was a bad joke. But what's happening here is that your brain is using past experiences of cats. It's creating a category, a concept on the fly for a cat. Now, cats can vary tremendously. I mean, they have some similarities in their features, right? They all have whiskers, they all have two eyes, they all have two pointy ears, the ears are approximately the same place. But they vary too, right? So they vary in their size, they vary in the color of fur, they vary in whether or not they have fur. They vary in all kinds of really interesting ways. And our brains are really facile at making categories, like kind of on the fly concepts. So you, if I asked you to make a concept for a cat, you might, depending on the context, maybe you would make a concept for a cat that's a good pet, like a tabby cat, right? Or maybe a Siamese cat. You might make a concept for a cat that's good at catching mice. You might make a concept for a cat that's in the zoo, like a big cat. If I asked you what is your the best example of the category bird, you would answer something differently if you were hungry and in a restaurant, or if you were in a pet store, or if you were in a park. This is work that was done actually in the mid-1980s by a scientist named Larry Barcelo as his doctoral dissertation. So your brain is making concepts as you need them and combining bits and pieces of experiences from the past to make an instance of a concept that, you know, you've never actually experienced before. And this is pretty much how brains work. And they don't just work this way for motion, they just work this way. So for example, when I show you this, how many of you see a cat? Yeah, it's because I just showed you a bunch of cats, and so it's really easy for your brain to make a cat. But as opposed to, say, an apple. In psychology, we call this priming. But basically, it's the operating principle of your brain. So your brain is not only builds concepts on the fly, it also builds them creatively, as I've shown you. It takes bits and pieces of past experience and combines them so that you can experience something new. So here's another character from Inside Out called Bing Bong. Let me introduce you. For those of you who haven't seen the movie, this is Bing Bong. How many of you have ever seen a pink elephant with fuzz and a striped tail before in your life? Assuming you haven't seen the Disney movie, Pixar movie, sorry. No, I hadn't either ever encountered a creature like this in real life. But still, we experience him in all of his pink glory there because our brain was able to make an ad hoc concept by combining different aspects of experience in a new way. So we've certainly seen elephants, and we've seen stuffed animal elephants, and we've seen pink pigs, and we've also... When we look at Bing Bong here, he kind of looks like a mischievous character. And there's a reason why he looks for a mischievous character, and that is because he has a tail that's just like the Cheshire Cat from Disney's Alice in Wonderland. So Disney has intuited, and Pixar have intuited this idea that brains can do what scientists call conceptual combination, or what neuroscientists call generativity, to combine bits and pieces of the past into something new, so that you not only see and experience something you've never experienced before, but you have an intuition about what this creature might be like. And actually, Bing Bong is quite mischievous in Inside Out, and he is used by the creators to actually explain something about how concepts work. And again, Pixar is relying on stereotypes. Because for a long time, people thought that concepts worked by abstraction, which is to say that when we have a concept for something, it's kind of stored in our head in this kind of pared-down, abstract way. So we could represent Bing Bong, as a pink triangle with a little curl. That concepts basically, the way they work in our brains is that they're represented as abstract symbols. But actually, a concept is not an abstraction, so this is a way, I have to tell you, the scene with Bing Bong, being abstracted like that is really, really entertaining, because he's such a goofball. And he gets the Inside Out characters and Miss Joy and Mr. Anger and so on in a lot of trouble. But it's also, it's a stereotype. In fact, really, concepts work more like this. Now, I don't know about you, but I've never in my life, actually in real life, seen a jumping electrical pylon. But yet, I know what it is. And how many of you actually can feel the pounding of the, you know, of the pylon jumping in your chest? Yeah, that's it. I saw you put your hand up. That brave person there put her hand up first. Yeah, I can. I mean, I've seen this probably 100 times, and I still feel it. And some people can actually hear it. This is an example of what scientists call, by various names, embodiment, simulation, perceptual inference, or just plain memory. I called it making a concept. What your brain is doing is this really remarkable thing. It's changing the firing of its own sensory neurons without any of the corresponding sensory input, so that you hear a thud and you feel a thud where there is no thud. So you see something, and your brain gives you the corresponding, starts to change the firing of its own neurons so that you hear something correspondingly, and you feel something correspondingly, and so on and so forth. So you know that old adage, or the old question, you know, if a tree falls in the forest and no one's there to hear it, does it make a sound? And we're supposed to think that this is a very clever kind of puzzle. The answer is really no, it doesn't make a sound, actually. If there's no ear there to transduce the changes in air pressure into a sound, there is no sound. And if you don't know what a tree is and you don't know what a tree sounds like, then that sound, even if you have an ear, will sound like noise to you. It will sound like basically something that you can't make sense of. It won't sound like a tree. You have to know what a tree is. It's something very similar to, say, when you're listening to someone who's speaking a language that you don't speak. The sounds have no meaning for you. They basically just sound like noise. You might not even be able to parse where the one word ends and another word begins, right? Or when I'm listening to dubstep, which my daughter likes to play, she's a musician, noise, it is noise. Actually, it has some meaning to me now, but originally it started out as noise. Heavy metal music, noise. But now my daughter's a heavy metal drummer, so to me, it sounds like music. So the way that concepts work, when I say that your brain is creating concepts and it's making meaning in a predictive way of the sensations in your body and from the sensations that come from the world, I'm not talking about this old-fashioned notion of concepts. I'm basically saying your brain's kind of doing this thing on the fly. It's doing it creatively. It's actually what a concept is changing the firing of your own sensory neurons. So, for example, how many people in this room have ever had a song going through their head that they can't get out of their head? Yeah. What your brain is doing in that moment essentially is making a concept. You wish it wasn't, but it is. Now, if that's not preposterous enough, I'm going to say one other thing that is important for us to understand when we're understanding how the brain makes emotion, and that is that, your brain didn't evolve, and so Mike sort of alluded to this. I am writing a book on brain evolution. I'm actually writing two books. I'm writing one for the public and then a scholarly book on brain evolution. With a very noted, the academic book, the scholarly book is with one of the great neuroscientists who studies evolution and developmental neurobiology, Barbara Finley, who is at Cornell University. But the popular book is all mine. It's actually sort of a celebration to all of the colleagues I have who have taught me neuroscience just out of the generosity of their own hearts and spirit. And one of the things I learned is that brains didn't evolve for us to think and feel and see. They actually evolved to regulate a body. That your brain's business is budgeting the internal resources of your body, like water and salt and glucose and hormones and so on, to keep you alive and well. And this continuous budgeting process is the reason why your brain evolved. As brains got bigger and environments, what we call an ecological niche, got larger and more complex, a brain, neurons had to kind of work together to form a brain to regulate that body in that environment so that you know whether something up ahead is something that you should eat or whether it might eat you. And this budgeting is your brain's basic job. We have a fancy name for it. It's called allostasis. What allostasis means is that your brain is anticipating the needs of the body and attempting to meet those needs before they arise, because it's efficient to do that. Your brain costs about 20% of your metabolic budget. About 70% of that metabolic budget goes to running your body. So basically, 14% of your entire metabolic budget goes to running your body. That's really expensive when you consider that a chimpanzee brain costs about 9% of that animal's budget, and a rat brain costs about 2%. So we have this really expensive brain, and it has to be efficient. And the way that it's efficient is by prediction. So this is the reason why when your brain is going to stand you up, it raises your blood pressure before it stands you up, so that oxygen, blood can get to your brain, and oxygen is there to keep you alive, lest you fall, right? You get lightheaded and fall, which, metabolically speaking, is kind of expensive. That wasn't even funny. There are enough older people in this room who are my age or older who know exactly what I'm talking about here. And this budgeting process is largely invisible to you because really, inside your body, you have this like symphony of sensory changes that come from body budgeting, which would be distracting. Philosophers call this tragic embodiment. You know, you're listening to something really serious on the radio while you're in your kitchen working, and you slice, you know, nick your finger with a knife, and all your attention goes to your finger. It's not a moral statement that anything else in the world is unimportant. It's just you can't help it. The sensations are just too intense. And so instead, you're wired so that you can't really, you don't really have good a sensory tracking of what's going on inside your own body, the way we do with vision. You know, so if you think about vision as sort of high-dimensional television, you know, inside your body is sort of more like a 1950s TV with really bad reception. And so evolution gave us a workaround that hints at our body budget, whether it's generally in balance or whether it's in the red, whether it's running a deficit. When it's generally in balance, you feel okay. And when you it's in the red, you know, when it's generally in balance, you feel pleasant or you feel comfortable. When it's not in balance, when you're in the red, when you're running a deficit, you feel pretty crappy. You can feel pretty miserable. You can feel really wretched, actually. And if it goes on for long enough, other systems get involved, like your immune system and so on, and you get sick. You get sick with a metabolic illness, which is heart disease, or cancer, or diabetes, or depression, or anxiety. And if it goes on for long enough, eventually Alzheimer's disease, all of which have a metabolic basis. And this workaround that evolution has given you, this feeling pleasant or feeling unpleasant, feeling really calm and kind of comfortable or feeling kind of wretched, is what we call affect. And affect, is a consciousness. It's with you every waking moment of your life because your brain is running your body budget every waking moment of your life. And sometimes when these affective properties are very strong, that's when we make them meaningful as an emotion in this culture. So when I'm having a perception of someone as a complete, as a complete not nice person for cutting me off on the highway, I'm having a perception that is intensely affective, even though my brain might be conjuring it into an emotion. So the general idea here is that, just to summarize, to sum up, is that your brain starts with initial conditions in the body and in the world, in your body and in the world. And it projects itself forward in time, making a prediction about what the body has to do next. That is what motor actions you have to take and what the actions are inside the body, in your heart, in your lungs, and so on, to prepare to support that action. Are you going to run? Are you going to sit quietly? Are you going to get up and walk around? Are you going to pat someone on the back? Are you going to give them a hug? And so on. And these commands that your brain is preparing to make to your body, systems of your body, internally and your motor system of your muscles and so on, these commands generate predicted sensory consequences that are like simulations or perceptual inferences. So these are, if I ask you, if I remind you about the song that goes through your head that you can't get out of your head, or if I ask you to imagine in your mind's eye an apple, a red apple, not a, like a Macintosh, not the kind that you type on, but the kind that you eat. How many of you can see an apple in your mind's eye? How many of you can, imagine the crunch of an apple when you bite into it? Or taste of an apple, the sort of, sweet kind of tart taste. Your brain is, if I were imaging your brain right now, as you do this, we'd see changes in activity in your visual system, in your auditory system, in your motor system. In fact, when we have people lie completely stock still in a scanner when we're doing brain scanning, and we see massive changes in the primary visual cortex, so the part of the brain that's supposed to be really important for vision, when their eyes are closed. And we see massive changes in motor cortex, even though they're lying completely still, as still as they can. And even we even see changes in all of the regions of the brain which are important for running the internal sensation, the internal systems of your body, even though they're not moving at all. These are the consequences, these illusions that we have, right, or these kind of like vague, ghost-like experiences, these are actually correspond to your brain changing the firing of its own neurons in preparation for incoming sensory inputs. So basically, your brain is making a prediction about what it should do next, and it also anticipates or predicts the sensory consequences of those movements. And then information, is continually arriving from the body and from the brain. From the body and from the world. And it can confirm the firing of the neurons that is already occurring. And then that becomes your experience. So that concept, that embodied concept which your brain made, then becomes the explanation for the sensations and the actions that your brain planned for you go forward. And we would say that the sensory inputs are categorized. They're made meaningful by that ad hoc concept that your brain constructed in this very embodied way. Alternatively, they might not match. In fact, there might be error, right? So maybe you anticipated something that didn't happen, or maybe you didn't anticipate something that did happen, and then your brain has to make a decision about whether it's going to learn this information or whether it's going to ignore it as noise. So, for example, it's possible that the apple, I ask you to imagine apple, I actually pull out an apple. And let's imagine that the apple is not exactly as red as you thought. Or maybe when you bite into it, it's a little sweeter than you thought. Or maybe not sweet enough. Or maybe it's a little mushy and it's not really firm enough. Your brain might just ignore that because it's irrelevant, really. You can't learn everything that you don't predict because that's too metabolically costly. Your brain has to make decisions about what it should learn and what it shouldn't. If you're baking an apple pie, it matters actually whether the apple is really mushy or not. And you might learn. You might encode the information and learn it so that your brain can predict better next time. So this is how an ache in your chest could be yearning or loneliness or anxiety or distrust or a heart attack, the beginnings of a heart attack. It's not that your brain is fooling yourself, it's that it's guessing. It's guessing at the meaning of sensory inputs based on the context. And, you know, using its past experience, its prior experiences. So this is the way that emotions are made. In fact, it's the way that all experiences that you have are made, and that all actions that you take are guided. And this is why I say that the emotions that seem to happen to you are actually made by you. And the emotions that you seem to detect, that you seem to read in other people, are partly actually coming from inside your own head. When you perceive emotion in another person, you are not reading emotion in that person. You are not detecting emotion in that person. You are guessing, right? Body language is not a language. Body movements are not a language. They are movements. You are guessing at their meaning. This has really, really important implications in many domains of life, including, for example, sexual consent over sex, which is like a really hot topic in the United States right now. So these and other aspects of the science of emotion and how our brains actually work and what it means actually about us as humans are discussed in more detail in my book, which is for sale tonight. I mentioned this public website where there are lots of videos and taped lectures like this one. And also, you can access all of the writing that I've done for the public. So I've written magazine articles. I write occasionally for the New York Times and so on. Where I'm connecting the science as we know it to topical issues. And what about cartoons? Like, what do we make about cartoons? Does this mean that I'm telling you not to go see Pixar's Inside Out, or apparently there's going to be an Inside Out 2 now? And the answer is no, of course I'm not telling you that. I love cartoons, actually. I'm a huge cartoon fan. In my house, actually, cartoons and superhero movies. Those are like the two big things that my whole family gets together to watch. And Pixar makes great movies. Right? They do a fantastic job of endowing all kinds of objects and agents with emotions. Toys, food, sea creatures. I don't know if you saw Dory, the Dory movie, which is like the best character I think a Pixar movie has ever had, this octopus. He is just my total favorite. Robots, aw, Wally, yeah. Insects, cars. They endow emotions in all of these objects, and now they do it with humans, which is not great science, but it is good fun. And so I would encourage you to watch the movie with those ideas in mind, with these ideas in mind. And I'll thank you for your attention.
Thank you so much. We would like to, at this time, invite questions from the audience. You may have noticed some microphones down here by the stage. If you have a question for Dr. Barrett, please come on down and ask it. We would ask that you keep the questions brief as possible, so we can get sort of maximal participation in this question and answer period. And we're not going to take that just on faith. You'll notice two very mean people standing by the microphone. I mean, Canadian mean. So they're going to say, sorry. No, I've lied to you. Neither of them are Canadian. So you've been warned.
Hi.
Don't be shy.
Oh, and hi. Thank you. My question is mostly for people who have chronic illness, since you talk about the brain, and how could we trick the brain not to feel what the brain is telling us that we need to feel?
That's a really great question. So I talk about this in my book, and I also talk about this in one of my TED Talks. Simply what I'll say is this. So I'll just give you one example. You can train your brain to take the distress that goes along with discomfort and turn the dial down on distress so all you feel is discomfort, which sounds like it's really hard, and it is. But it's kind of like driving. It takes a lot of effort at first, but you can learn to do it. So what you're teaching your brain, you're sort of teaching it, you're cultivating an opportunity for your brain to learn new experiences, which become part of that model that then it can use automatically. And when this happens, for example, with patients who are suffering from chronic pain, when they learn to transform, or I would say categorize, sensory inputs as discomfort instead of distress, they can reduce their opioid use and actually reduce their opioid dependence. It sounds preposterous, but it actually works. I just want to be really clear that for some very serious for some really serious illnesses, it's not really, you can't just perform a couple of Jedi mind tricks and then like feel differently, right? So I'm not saying you can like talk yourself out of a serious illness, but I am telling you, for example, that you could, there are clinical trials for major depression that use ibuprofen and acetaminophen. Why? Because the visceral systems inside your body can send information to your brain about damage, which is called nociception. And so your brain starts to, its model, it's guessing that there's some damage there. And so you experience feeling wretched. And if you take ibuprofen, that feeling goes away. Now, when you're a person who's suffering from major depression, in a world that, I would have said that in a world that makes a Western world that makes really strong mind-body distinctions, but I just heard her talk about this today, so I'm really nervous to say that, but I'm just going to say it anyways. We'll take one thing for a mood disturbance and another thing for pain. But that's just a myth, really. And we have an opioid problem in this country because people are distressed. Pain is also an emotion, according to the scientists who study it. It's just a way of making sense of sensations. And you have a lot more flexibility over how you do that. It's not easy, but you can do it. I know you said short questions, but that mostly meant short answers, but I'm just, brevity is not my strong suit. I'm really sorry. It's just, that's how it is. Yeah.
Hi, thanks for your presentation.
Yeah.
I don't know, maybe I just talk loud.
There we go. Yeah. Okay.
What is consciousness, what is its role in regard to emotions?
Yeah, so there's no way in a room full of philosophers that I am going to define for you consciousness. I'm just not doing it. That's a trick somebody planted you here.
Can I take a secondary question?
Though, is this, that you know how I was saying that something physical, like the sensations from body budgeting, from allostasis, are conjured into something mental, like affect, feelings of pleasantness or unpleasantness. That is a question. That is the core question of consciousness. And what I'll say is that we don't know how it happens, actually. We know that it does, and we can kind of point to parts of the brain that seem important for doing that, and that passes as an explanation for some people, but it isn't. I can't answer that question. I don't know. I think what you might be... I don't know if this is what you're asking me. Sometimes people ask, what's the role of feeling an emotion, and can you have an emotion and not feel it? And that's a complex question. And it's partly complex because in different parts of the world, emotions mean different things. In this country, in Western societies, feeling is part of emotion. And in many Eastern societies and small-scale rural societies, emotions are just predictions of action. And we're not saying that people don't feel. We're just saying feeling in those cultures is not part of what it's not part of what your brain is making sense of in emotion. So, basically that's my fancy way of telling you I can't answer that. I can't answer your question. Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah. Sure.
Thanks for the great talk.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Yeah, so I guess during some of my psychology classes, I've heard before, it's like your brain can kind of associate like smiling with happiness. Mm. So then you can kind of trick your brain by like smiling first, and that can make you happier.
Mm.
So considering your talk kind of saying that you can't really tell like emotions from like facial expressions, I was wondering what your opinion was on that.
Sure, so what you're asking me about is something called the facial feedback hypothesis, mm-hmm. which people believe was... invented by Sylvan Tompkins in the 1960s, actually first proposed by Floyd Allport, who is the brother of the more famous Gordon Allport, who is a social psychologist. And Floyd Allport had this idea that if you move your face in a particular way, that sends feedback to your brain, which causes you to have the emotion. So if you smile, then you'll feel happy. What the predictive hypothesis is, what it looks like is happening, is something slightly different, which is the following. That based on the current situation right now, if you could just freeze it, your brain is taking the current state of things in the world and in your body and making a prediction about what's going to happen next. And it's preparing an action. It's preparing you to smile, say. So we've never met. Right. But let's say I just, right? I think we've never met. Yeah, so we've never met. But let's say I'm presuming you're a friendly person. My brain is predicting you're friendly, and it's preparing me to smile. And it's preparing me to have the sensory consequences of smiling. Now, how did it prepare me to smile? Well, it's making a concept. It's making a concept, you might say, of happiness, or you might say of friendliness, or you might say, right? It's using past experiences where in a similar situation, I smiled, somebody else smiled, right? And I'm expecting you to smile. That's part of my predicted sensory consequence. And if you start to smile, then that confirms my prediction and I smile. So in a sense, smiling can influence feeling happy, but not for the reasons that you read about in your textbooks. The logic of what comes first and what comes second is slightly not correct according to our best guess at what the right hypothesis is. And it's a little more complicated than that, but I think that's the general gist of what I'm saying. So it's a good idea to smile. Just remember that smiling in your brain your smiling doesn't only come from a concept of happiness. It can come from many other concepts. And in fact, in many cultures around the world, smiling is not a sign of happiness at all. It's a sign of other things, which I'll just leave it there.
Thank you.
Yeah.
All right, thanks for coming to London.
Sure.
You touched on some gender things like anxiety and female heart attacks and body language and implied consent. I'm wondering, in all of your research, is there really differences in the female and male brain? Some have speculated cell packing density, wider corpus callosum. Can you get into that a little bit for us tonight?
Sure. I can start with emotion first, which is what I know best, but then I can speak more generally about the brain. So there's a very strong belief in this culture and other, not everywhere, but Western cultures generally, that women are more emotional than men. If you ask women, are you more emotional than men? On average, they'll say yes. And if you ask men, they'll confirm, yes, women are more important, more emotional than me. If you take those same women and men and you actually follow them in a moment-to-moment way across many days and you look at their episodes of emotion that they report, there are no differences between men and women. There are some people who have more episodes and some people who have fewer, but on average, men and women don't differ. Now, in an experiment, and I've actually done this, and if this were a different talk, I would have actually presented. I probably have the slides here if you want to see them after the talk. What we do is we take a face, and we that's making a stereotyped expression, like a smile or a scowl, or actually we didn't use smiling. We only used scowling and wide-eyed, gasping faces that are supposed to be fear, the stereotype of fear in this culture and in other cultures. That's actually the stereotype of anger, but you know, our subjects were from here, and so on and so forth. A wrinkled nose, that's the stereotype for disgust. And we had subjects, we had people pose those faces, and then we gave subjects, you know, an explanation, like how to fight with their boss, or you know, their dog died, or you know, something like that. We show people these faces, and then with the explanations, and then later we just show them the faces, and we ask them to remember the sentence, remember the situations, which they do, and then we ask them to make a judgment: is this person having a bad day, or is this person just an emotional person? Now the faces are an amalgam of a male and a female face, and we just stick female hair on in one condition, and we stick male hair on the other condition. The faces are identical. It's just the hair that's different. What do you think? Yeah, you know, right? She's a bitch. I mean, bad. She's bad. She's bad. I'm sorry. She's not nice. She's having, you know, she's a not nice person. She's very emotional. He's just having a really bad day. Now, I had a lot of fun as a scientist and a lot of angst, as a lot of grief as a person living in the United States during the 2016 election. Because I wrote an op-ed about this in the New York Times, because this is actually what you saw. You know, when a woman's angry, she's just a bitch, basically. When a man's angry, well, that's an indication that something's wrong in the world. Now, you know, these weren't absolute differences. I mean, they were probabilistic, right? But my point is that, you know, when Hillary Clinton, regardless of what you think about her, right, when she violated the sex role stereotype of being an emotional woman, then she was called, you know, basically cold and untrustworthy. And in fact, we have evidence to show that when someone violates your expectations, you find them untrustworthy and cold. And Donald Trump, to some extent, you know, he was angry because, you know, you need to make America great again. He's angry because something's wrong in the world. And so you saw these gender stereotypes just completely play out. I'm not saying that's the only reason why the election went the way that it did, but you know, you could have I did predict it really in advance, just on the basis of that. I'll just say one quick note about the male versus the female brain. This is a highly debated thing. I'm going to sort of say two things. One is that there are lots of differences that have been found between male and female brains. None of them, as far as I know, predict anything strongly about behavior. So there's a lot of variability in my brain and your brain, and that not everything predicts behavior. That's the first thing to say. The second thing I'll say, though, is that female brains, one thing we discovered, and I have to say, if I hadn't seen it in my own data, I probably wouldn't believe it, frankly. Ovarian hormones do affect degree of connectivity between certain groups of neurons in the brain. And so there are periods of time in the menstrual cycle of a woman where her brain, her resting connectivity between certain collections of neurons is changing. And this is in the mid-luteal phase, right after ovulation, where estrogen's going down and progesterone is going up. And what we see is this change in connectivity, which may predispose women to mood disorder if something bad happens to them during this period. So in other studies, when these two networks are very connected, anybody is better able to remember negative material, you're more stressed by that material, it takes a bigger withdrawal from your body budget, basically. so you're better able to remember it. You have a stronger affective reaction to it. You know, your affect is stronger. This is true of everybody, but it is also the case that the networks seem to be, these groups of neurons seem to be changing their connectivity on a month by, like, depending on the cycle. We're now actually looking at this in men too, because there are daily changes in connectivity based on things like testosterone, for example. So it's not, I'm not saying that women only have a vulnerability, but I am saying that there are these, there may be differences that are important. But this sort of idea of, like, there's a male brain, there's a female brain, I don't see a lot of evidence that's true.
Thank you for the talk.
Okay. Sure. Thanks for coming.
Thank you. My question was, when you were talking about an emotion following a circuit in the brain, I was wondering if each emotion is following this circuit, does it become stronger the more frequently that it is experienced by the person, and then perhaps cause that person to experience that specific, more stronger emotion more?
Yes.
Okay. Perfect.
Hello. I was just wondering, there's a little study done where there was a baby reacting to mother's emotions, and I think it was like a 5 or 6 month old baby, where the mother would laugh and the baby would laugh, and then when she went stone-faced, the baby just started to cry. So I'm just wondering, like, when you think these emotional learning starts, like super early on, like when it's observing the mother and other faces around, like learning from their sort of emotional, just wondering when that starts, you think?
Yeah, so I would say infants don't observe a mother laughing and perceive emotion. There's no evidence for that, actually. It's been tested, and there's no evidence for that. But affect, babies are born with the capacity to feel pleasure and pain, and they are, it looks as if very early on, although it's not clear exactly when because of how the studies are done, but maybe as early as 3 months, and I would think maybe even before that. My intuition tells me before that, but the data suggests around 3 months, that babies are able to guess at the affect. They're able to guess whether, from cues, whether someone is feeling pleasant or unpleasant. But what your question about is, I talk about this in the book, and there's a paper that we published in Nature Human Behavior, actually about this point. So I'm going to try to say this in the least politically charged way that I can. I know, right? It looks like learning that is based on, infants don't learn about, they don't learn based on feeling, we don't know that. They might be learning based on how other people are managing their body budget. So a baby can't manage its own body budget. It can't feed itself, clothe itself, regulate its own temperature. It can't even move its limbs, actually. It doesn't know when to sleep, and it doesn't even know how to, babies don't even, aren't born knowing how to nurse. Anyone who's ever had a baby and tried to nurse a baby, you know what I'm talking about. You have to teach a baby how to do it, right? And that has consequences. So a mother or a father or a caregiver is basically maintaining the body budget of that infant, and there are interoceptive consequences of that, and therefore there are affective consequences of that. So it's not clear what's driving the learning. Is it the affect, or is it the feeling, or is it the sensations themselves? We don't really know the answer. But it happens super early, probably even in the last trimester. Because other sorts of statistical learning we know are happening in the last trimester. A baby is born, it doesn't see very well, it doesn't hear very well, but if you place a baby on its mother's belly immediately after birth, it will wriggle its way up to her breast by smell. Because it knows the smell of the amniotic fluid, which is the same smell as the colostrum coming from her breast. And there's some evidence to suggest that babies also are learning, well, that fetuses in the last trimester, if you take a preemie that's born in the last trimester, and it's not fully, I mean, so it's not, not only is it, I mean, a little infant brain is not a miniature adult brain. It's a brain that is waiting for wiring instructions from the world, right? But some of those wiring instructions also happen in utero in the last trimester. So, for example, if you take a preemie and you play muffled sounds of the mother's voice to that preemie in its crib in the NICU, then you see corresponding changes in auditory cortex development, so that proceeding along the way you would expect it to for a neurotypical infant. So the learning, we don't know how early the learning starts, frankly, but it starts definitely for interoception and affect, I would say definitely, I would say at birth, frankly, because you're doing things to this infant which is managing its body budget. And that is what that's how an infant learns what's rewarding and what's punishing.
So I do have a question for you, which is, it is 8:30. I know you're heading out of town tonight.
Yeah, my ride comes at 8:45, so I probably have another five minutes.
Let's do one more question then, and I'm sorry.
Phew, I thought you were going to ask me a really hard question.
Let's do one more question, and then we'll draw this too close. Thank you.
Okay.
Hi, I was wondering if you could speak to the relationship between our use of language and emotion, for instance, earlier when you were talking about the difference between distress and discomfort, or I had a lot more success managing my emotional dysregulation when I approached it as not controlling my emotions, but managing them. So I was wondering if you could speak to that.
Absolutely, absolutely. So again, this is something we talk about in the book, and it's there's more to say about this than I have time to say about it here. I mean, I talk about this in the book. We have papers also on our website, academic website, where we've actually run studies. But I guess what I would say is this, words are a very effective way to learn how to make new emotion concepts for many reasons. That is explained in the book and in my papers, which I don't have time to explain now. But here's the really interesting thing. When you train students, for example, young kids, when you improve their emotion vocabulary, the whole climate of the classroom changes. And they learn to regulate their behavior better. They actually, surprisingly, do better on in academic testing, even. In part because all concepts that your brain makes are ways of regulating your body, first and foremost. And that's important. So it turns out that if people know more words for negative emotions, so they, instead of just feeling like crappy, they can make specific instances. So what do you do when you feel crappy? Who knows? I mean, but when you're angry or when you're sad or when you're frustrated if you have a bigger vocabulary and you can make more specific instances of these categories with these ad hoc concepts, then you're better able to regulate your behavior. Your brain is better able to plan action in a specific situation. And it turns out that there's this whole literature showing, some of it is our work, some of it is work by other people, showing that if you are more granular in your vocabulary for negative emotions, you actually show evidence of regulating better. People who are more granular about negative emotions, so they're experiencing more frequently specific negative emotions. Let me say that slightly differently. That when they experience negativity, they are experiencing it as a specific emotion with a specific behavioral consequence. These are people who are less likely to develop depression and anxiety, who are less likely to rely on alcohol as a means of coping, who are less likely to engage in aggressive behavior towards someone who is provoking them. And surprisingly, actually, these are people who recover, there's some evidence that people recover more quickly from cancer, for example, and from other diseases, in part because of this link between body budgeting and the concepts that your brain can make. So learning new emotion words, expanding your emotion vocabulary, even to learn to easily make concepts, to practice making concepts from other cultures that widen your emotion vocabulary, is a really effective way for many people to become more of the architects of their emotional life. Yep.
Thank you, everybody, for coming tonight. Really appreciate it.